welcome back to another Lefebvre's Friday for September 16th, 2016. How you doing? How's it going? So what have I been up to? What have I been doing? What is new and fantastic and different this week? Well, not very much on the side of, you know, media consumption, but video games. I've been looking at video games, which, you know, under the title on Twitch, Gaming Talk Show, I guess I should do that every so often. So I've made it to season 4 of Farscape, and god damn, do they like recycling themes on Farscape. Farscape season 1 started off with Krace, a commander of the, not the Freelancers, what the hell, the Peacekeepers, yes. Commander Krace encounters our protagonist, John Crichton, and he believes that John killed his brother. So he decides to pursue him across uncharted territories of space to get revenge on him. Season 2. Krace is still after Crichton, but they introduce a new antagonist, Scorpius. Scorpius discovers that John Crichton has wormhole technology in his brain, and he wants it. And John Crichton escapes, and Krace and Scorpius work together to pursue John Crichton across space. Krace no longer wanting to fucking kill him because of retribution for his brother, maybe a little bit, but Scorpius mainly just obtained the wormhole technology that is locked in John's brain. Season 3, Krace decides to leave the Peacekeepers, and he takes off with Talon, which is the offspring of Moya, the living ship that they've been spending all their time on in Farscape. And Scorpius now becomes the pursuer. And Krace wants asylum on Moya to escape the Peacekeepers. And him and... Actually, I think a little bit of that occurred in Season 2 as well. Maybe. Yeah. And so Scorpius is now pursuing John Crichton across space. And, you know, John has now become allies with the Peacekeeper, Krace, that was hunting him down for the first... season and a half, first two seasons. And now they have a new enemy to avoid. And now season 4 has arrived, and Krace is dead. Scorpius is now established asylum on Moya. He is no longer pursuing John Crichton. And now there's this new Peacekeeper General chick who was insulted by Crichton because, you know, she can't stand to have anybody look down on her or cause any insult to her, so now she's after him to kick his ass and kill him, or I don't... And it's kind of funny how the show actually acknowledges that. He's like, is there... they made the joke when Scorpius had come aboard Moya, and he's like, hey, I want asylum on this ship. I want to escape the Peacekeepers because they want to murder me now. Yeah, it's a good show. I love Farscape. That's why I've been able to burn through it so quickly. I'm about halfway through season 4, and then I have the Peacekeeper Wars to watch, and then it'll be it. It'll be done. It'll be over. And then I'll have to, well, watch another, well, find another show to binge on a frequent basis. But yeah, John at the beginning of season 4, where Scorpius shows up on Moya asking for asylum, he's like, is there some sort of rotating door of assholes, or some sort of line referring to the fact that we've done this already? This isn't new. How come we're recycling the same kind of thing? But I guess that's, well, has been the constant theme of Farscape. But, you know, a lot of people, you know, from season to season like change. Not too much change, but just enough change that it doesn't become, you know, samey, boring, and predictable in a sense where it's like, man, if they were got season 5, I bet you that evil Peacekeeper chick would probably want asylum because some new big bad would show up. It would probably be an alliance between the Skarrens and the Peacekeepers, and some Skarren commander would be like, we want John Crichton, and we're gonna kill that commander chick of the Peacekeepers because she doesn't fit, she hates Skarrens or whatever in this new regime. If there was going to be a season 5, hell, that might be what happens in the Farscape Wars miniseries. I don't fucking know yet, but I look forward to finding out. And I find it amusing how, you know, Farscape, I didn't hear a lot of how amazing the show was, maybe because I wasn't paying attention, perhaps just because I wasn't listening. And you know, people rave to the high heavens how Firefly is the greatest sci-fi show that ended far before its time, and maybe it's because Farscape got 88 episodes plus a miniseries as well, that it didn't, mind you, it may be raved as a wonderful sci-fi success in Australia, where it initially started, and where it probably got a majority of its budget until, I think, season 4, then either they went to high definition or they were just picked up by a different channel. And they, you know, were starting to be featured on the Sci-Fi Channel and Space, North American television channels that, you know, brought it to my attention in the first place that I never really cared about because I just wanted to watch SG-1, damn it. But how they keep recycling the same themes, and I look at Bleach, another medium that, you know, has ended recently, and a lot of it, a lot of people saying that the failing of Bleach was that it kept recycling the same thing. It went through the Shinigami arc, and then after that, it went on to the Hueco Mundo arc, which was pretty much identical. It was a bunch of people in a foreign land trying to take on an established regime. And, hey, Ziploc Bob, how's it going? Welcome. God damn. I gotta stop showering before streaming because that's why I get so fucking sweaty. Tried to cool down with an ice cube or a whiskey rock, but ain't helping it. Yeah, that was one of the major things that destroyed Firefly, was that they canceled the show way too early, and the studio was just, well, that was, I think that was Fox. It was that time where Fox was like, oh man, if they're not getting 30 million viewers, fuck this show. I'm not too exactly sure who had the reins on Firefly. Pretty sure it was Fox. I'll look it up just to be sure. It's kind of funny, my brother would always tell me that a lot of Firefly was shot in Fort Edmonton Park. And I'm like, I don't know about that. Yeah, it was Fox that fucking had Firefly. And it turned out, nah, none of it was shot in Edmonton. The only association with Edmonton that Firefly has is Nathan Fillion, the lead actor who, well, grew up in Edmonton. Yeah. Thanks, Bob. I didn't know. Great to have you. yeah, so Farscape, fucking awesome. Really like that. One issue I've run across with season 4 is that it's not looking HD. It's finally 16:9 aspect ratio. Yeah, Fox ruined a lot of really prominent shows between like 1995 and 2005. They just burned through tons of shit. But, you know, I was expecting Farscape season 4 to look sharper and crisper because apparently it was shot in high definition or 1080i, but, well, Jesus, if they could find the original 35mm prints of the first 3 seasons, that show would fucking look fantastic. But maybe it's just because I'm watching it on Netflix and bitrate and compression and crushing and all that. It could look a lot better. But it just looks more the same and fills up the screen finally. And, you know, kind of an advantage of watching Farscape the first 3 seasons and the 4:3 aspect ratio, which it's only provided in, unfortunately, is that a couple weeks back I was playing, I think it was just last week actually, Ratchet and Clank. And the thing with Ratchet and Clank is that the game came out in 2001 on the PlayStation 2. And, yeah, or 2002, one of those years. I keep messing that up, but... And the cinematics that are not in-engine are at 4:3 aspect ratio, and that really bothered me for some weird reason. And I finally finished Ratchet and Clank, and Jesus Christ, are the skill points in that game a lot fucking harder than I remember. Then again, when I played it for the first time, I had nothing but time on my hands to just grind out bolts and skill points, and with the new game plus, gold weapons and everything like that, it just, they want... 60,000 bolts per gold weapon plus gold bolts. Well, I have all the gold bolts. That was pretty easy to find. But to grind out those 60,000 per is just... Fuck, that's going to take probably 2 more playthroughs. Full playthroughs of the game to accomplish that. And it's just like, Jesus Christ. Yeah. Good old Fox shows. I don't know. I don't mind campy. Bigger, better. fucking Netflix. Jesus, look at Game of Thrones. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and better. But yeah, Stargate's first couple of seasons, the gold. Yeah, that's the thing, is you try keep going through that old Dragon Ball Z power creep, where it's like, oh, this guy, now that he's Super Saiyan 2, fucking this big bad has to be able to defeat him, so they have, well, then it gets silly, and they have to go for another level beyond that, and another level beyond that. Oh, man, I gotta catch up on Game of Thrones. I fell off at season 4 when I got an email from HBO to stop stealing their shit, and I have not gotten back to it yet, so season 5 and 6 are completely up in the air for me, and I've heard everything about them, because I'm not precious about spoilers, but, and that, and I listened to the audiobook, so I knew practically everything that was happening up until, I guess, the beginning of season 6, when they started, doing shit that's beyond the books now. Thanks, George R.R. Martin. You'll get to that one day. Yes, that power creep, I suppose, is something that, I don't know. To have a big baddie and all that in sci-fi shows like Stargate and Farscape, I don't think you have to have a new, bigger, badder, even more powerful enemy. You just have to have someone... Well, I kind of think of Star Wars. Star Wars, they're not constantly coming out with a bigger and eviler guy. They just have one big evil dude, and they keep throwing his minions at you. And I think of General Thrawn, for example. That is a villain who's not more powerful than everybody else, who's not fucking more, evil. Well, actually, he is a lot more evil than everyone else, but the thing that everyone loves about General Thrawn is that he's cold, calculated, and a majority of the shit that he tried, or the plans they attempted, all succeeded, or a majority of them succeeded, until... I don't know what ever really happened with those. I have to listen to those Thrawn books. I'm only going off of secondary information, hearsay, but Star Wars doesn't run into that issue, or Star Trek didn't really have that issue as well, where it's like, they never came out with anything worse than the Borg. They kind of stopped at that point with that power creep of enemies. They were coming up with a bunch of different enemies, and... yeah, exactly, Bob. That's the wonderful thing, but I guess that's something that requires a lot of effort and, just building and the budget or the time, I suppose, to develop that villain to make them more interesting and compelling. And I guess that's something that is easier to be like, let's introduce a new evil person, because this current evil person... I guess we've mined the depths of them already. We didn't give them enough, or just the room for them to grow, or the possibilities. They could have went into singular episodes of the enemies in such shows like Stargate or Farscape, for example, since I'm very into it right now, to have Scorpius, instead of having some new evil peacekeeper come in and replace him and drive him out, thus... kind of recycling the same theme of him and Krace, maybe have him rise in the ranks, have him achieve some sort of goal, or to move on or be reassigned to a different position, and him trying to work his way back instead of just completely blowing off all of his responsibilities and going rogue like Krace did as well. That's kind of what Scorpius had done, but sci-fi, easier to have them be more powerful, but that's a kind of staying point of a good villain, is, you don't have to make him more powerful, and you just have to make him more interesting, more compelling. It's just, I want to see. I hate that guy. It's kind of like a good villain in wrestling. That's the thing. Wrestling villains, they don't get more powerful or evil. Sometimes they do, through different means than just actual physical strength, but they become more interesting. They change. They have that heel turn, that face turn. Sometimes they become the good guy for a little bit, then they become the bad guy again, and they're even more evil. And you just love to hate them. That villain you love to hate, and just having that tenacity, I suppose, to it. I'll see you in a moment then, Hexter. The villains you can relate with, that's the ones that you enjoy, Bob. You're like, yeah, that guy's a dick, and he killed some babies, but you know, I see his point about a few things here and there. Maybe not that extreme, but yeah, that's what makes a enemy a bit more engaging. Yeah, Star Wars. Yeah, well, the Sith, that's the thing. Just having a villain and sticking with it where, well, Thrawn wasn't a Sith, but he was a Republic? Shit, I never watched much of Star Wars, and if I did, I fell asleep. So yes, I beat Ratchet and Clank the first game, and I cheesed the hell out of a lot of those skill points. Man, oh man, some of those were a bastard. There's still one that evades me, and it's the hoverboard, because the hoverboard sucks. I actually had to, there was one challenge or skill point where you had to get 4,500 points in a hoverboard track, and I found this perfect spot where if I kept jumping off, it kept resetting me, so I pretty much got about 6,000 points on my first lap due to just jumping off this one section, landing the trick, and then having it reset me back. And it reset me back so much that I guess I hit a certain point that put me back at an earlier point of the track where I got a couple of really good jumps off. And I'm like, fucking A. That's how you bullshit a goddamn skill point, which ended up being a trophy. And accomplishing a goal without having to, well, do it legitimately. Fuck that. If you're gonna put in challenges like that that require skill, nah. Sure, they call it a skill point, but some of those things are pretty damn easy. Like, oh, shoot 5 vehicles on this island, or break these lights on this planet. And it's like, okay, I can do that shit. And some of it, not very hard, actually pretty pathetic. And other ones just, well, I complete the hoverboard track in 1 minute and 35 seconds. I believe I was talking about this last week. I managed to get my time down to 1:36.5. I have to shave 1.5 seconds off, and I found a YouTube video that shows me of, like, cutting the track, but to have the fucking dexterity to do that, I don't know if I possess that anymore. Jesus Christ. So I moved on to Ratchet & Clank Going Commando, the second game. I'll save the grinding for gold, well, the grinding for bolts and that goddamn last skill point for some time in the future while I have the patience. Maybe my 24-hour charity stream. I'll fucking be like, hey, let's play Ratchet and Clank for a few hours and see if I can just get some bolts. I got all the weapons. I just want to get the gold ones now. Fuck. And, oh my god, just the marketable difference between Ratchet and Clank and Going Commando. Going Commando, it finally added in strafing. The camera controls are a hell of a lot better. The weapons are upgradable, so you don't have the same stagnant weapon the whole time. You actually get a better weapon as time goes along. So, good villain. After you went through, right? Dr. Doom. Yeah, Dr. Doom. That guy, he changed a lot. Seen as a benevolent leader of Latveria. Most probably. Yeah, well, that's the thing, is that Dr. Doom really isn't a bad guy. He's just a guy that does bad things to accomplish his goal, which I guess could be seen as a bad guy, but it's not like he's a villain. It's not like he wants to take over the world for utmost power. He wants to do it for altruistic means. Dr. Doom, to my knowledge, as far as I know him, I've never really read a lot of Fantastic Four comics, but I do know a little bit of the history of Dr. Doom, is that he just wants to make the world, like, Latveria is, you know, a prosperous and well-off country because he's a great ruler, and he feels that under his rule, the world could be the same, utopia. And that's what he's trying to accomplish, but the way he is going about it is with an iron fist, and quite literally, an iron fist. And that's just something that, you know, a lot of people, if given the chance, I bet you there's a what if series. Marvel has done that before, what if series. I bet you there's a what if series if Dr. Doom conquered the world. And I bet you it looks like a really, really swell place. But with Ratchet & Clank Going Commando, yeah, love upgrading the weapons, love upgrading the character. Ton of fun. Loving it. I came up with a good system that has been working for me quite well this week. Is instead of sitting down and watching people play video games, just watching, that's what I tend to do throughout a majority of my week if I'm not, you know, watching Farscape or eating and shitting and sleeping. I watch Witwicks streaming, and I watch Achievement Hunter videos, or I've been getting a little bit back into that. Or the Switcher channel, Two Best Friends Play. Fucking love those guys. But I'm like, I'm not getting anything really done. I'm just sitting around watching other people's content. So what I've been doing, instead of just sitting there watching it, I put it on my tablet or I put it on my computer. And a majority of it, I'm not watching just for the gameplay. I'm watching for a mixture of the gameplay, the experience, and the flavor text, the personalities of the individuals that I like listening to. Hell, I love the Super Best Friends podcast, 3 hours long. Hell, Giant Bombcast, 3 hours long as well. I just love listening to these people talk and discuss and wax poetically about video games, life, experiences, and all kinds of things. Kind of maybe the same reason you guys show up here. Or the hell type of character is no intention, so you've actually shown them up to be. No, I'm not taking notes. I'm playing video games. Instead of just watching people, I'm fucking playing video games as well. So I listen to them in the background, and that's how I managed to finish off Ratchet & Clank. That's how I got a couple hours of Ratchet & Clank going commando in today. And why I've been able to play this group of list of video games that I'm going to talk about. I played a game that I have on Steam that I bought, I guess, a couple of years ago. I don't even know why. It's called Alien Swarm. It's some kind of four-player isometric top-down shooter. Yeah, it's just a shooter game where you play a bunch of space marines from kind of a Diablo perspective, except you know, you got guns. I suppose Diablo has arrows, but still. And it's kind of just a little bit of story, but I think the main draw of it is the online multiplayer. And since I don't have anyone to play with, I played through the practice thing just to get an idea of what the hell the game is about, and lost two out of my four squad mates, made out with me and the other person, fucking lucky there. Or was it five? I think it was actually five people. Might be wrong there, because typically they stick it to equal numbers, but yeah, it was an interesting, kind of fun game, better with, well, other people to play with, and I don't know, depending on the age of the game, I don't know how active the online community is for it. So I don't think I really see myself playing it and relying on AI, although I imagine the AI is probably a lot more reliable than going online. So maybe I'll try that out. Maybe I'll try out the campaign and see what I think of it. But so far off my first impressions of it, it seems like a pretty fun game. It's, you know, not quite my thing, but yeah. I'll give it another go. I think I put about an hour into it, and I'll put a couple more hours into it and let you know what I think by the end of that. I played some Command & Conquer Red Alert 3. Red Alert 3. Another game. Actually, Command & Conquer Red Alert 3 Uprising. So not the regular Red Alert 3, but the DLC, which had George Takei with the Island of the Rising Sun, or whatever the hell they called them in the Command & Conquer universe. Japan. Nippon. And, you know, I like RTS games. I think that's what it is. Real-time strategy. I played Age of Empires way back in the day. Hell, I played the first Warcraft, Orcs and Humans. Warcraft 2, Tides of Darkness, and Warcraft 2, The Dark Portal. I think that's what the subtext or the suffix to that was. And StarCraft 2, played all three chapters of that. What the hell? Wings of Liberty, Heart of the Swarm, and Into the Void? No, I don't think that's it. I think that's a Ratchet & Clank game, Into the Void. Legacy of the Void. That's it. So I really enjoy the RTS genre, but I've never, ever played any Command & Conquer game. So I tried out this Command & Conquer 3, Red Alert 3 Uprising, that I bought on Steam years ago. And I must have bought it on some sort of EA sale and got a bunch of those games. Fuck that game. Just shit. I don't know if it's a matter of jumping into, well, I think they had like 4 and then Generals. I think they had about 2 or 3 games after it. Don't like it. Don't like the formula of it. Don't like the enemy movement or the character movement, the squad, how to lay that out. It's just, I don't know if it's too different from the Age of Empires and the StarCraft and WarCraft formula or what, but I just, no, did not enjoy that whatsoever. Hell, even going back and playing a bit of Age of Empires 2 a couple of months ago, I found that the pace and the movement, like, the game was just glacial. It was too fucking slow. Maybe that was just being a little bit too, what the hell is it? When you're given too much. Spoiled, that's it. Being spoiled way too much by StarCraft 2 and the fast pace of that. StarCraft as well. And WarCraft, I suppose, picked up on that. Although I played a little bit of WarCraft 3 for the first time a few months back. And yeah, that kind of forces you not to what I usually do in Age of Empires is build up all my defenses, build a giant army, go and crush the fucking five dudes running a farm. I'm like, well, I didn't need to spend 8 hours building up that army, then move on to the next campaign. I'm like, fuck. Where, yeah, Command and Conquer, you know, I played it for through the first two missions, and I just, no. Maybe it's just something I don't understand. Maybe I need to go back and play some of the older ones, get a bit more acquainted with the changes that they made, or if that this is how it's been the whole time, then fuck that series. Maybe I'll try going back and playing one of the older ones, and if I find that there's nothing interesting or compelling there, then sorry, Command and Conquer people, you play a shit game, in my opinion. Another game I checked out was Iron Brigade. Iron Brigade, I had no clue what the fuck this was. I thought it was kind of like, the hell is that? Shooter, walking, full, best friend's been, whatever. I don't remember what the hell I'm thinking of. But Iron Brigade, it's this kind of alt-World War I, World War II. I think it's World War II, where this mad scientist is taking over the world with these creatures that he calls tubes, but they're television screens, like old CRT television screens, inside these giant monsters, and you're inside of a big-ass mech. Not like an awesome, sweet Jaeger, but a really fucking rough World War II kind of era mech, where it's just legs and guns. Doesn't really even have a torso. It's an open canopy to the thing. And it's just a wave-based shooter. It's just, I guess, horde mode kind of makes a bit of sense for that. Where, you know, just a lot of enemies come in, you shoot them, you upgrade your weapons. And it has online. So I think it can get up to 4 players, which would be fun. But that online community, I decided to try checking that out, is dead. Found one other person there so overleveled that I was just a burden to play with them. And I'm like, fuck it. Maybe I can find someone who's not so overleveled. And nope, that did not happen. Either way, you know, it was a lot of fun. I actually really enjoyed that. Ended up playing it for an hour or so. I'll go back to it. I kind of went back to grind earlier levels just so I could upgrade shit a little bit better and be able to stand on my own just in case I get into a multiplayer game with another person that's way more powerful than me. I might be able to, you know, help. Sniper Elite 2. That was a game that I watched people play for, like, on the internet from time to time. And I'm like, this looks interesting. And then when it went on sale on Steam a long time ago, I think I bought this game like 2-3 years ago as well. I'm like, ah, fuck. I'll finally check this out. And Jesus Christ, did I fall down a rabbit hole. Sniper Elite 2. God damn. I ended up playing it for like 2 hours. I just wanted to look at it for like 15 minutes and see what I thought of it. And next thing I know, I'm like, Jesus, I've been playing for, well, a hell of a lot longer than I anticipated. I started playing at like 2 in the morning and it was like 4:30 where I'm like, oh, fuck. I should stop playing this and go to bed or something. And yeah, that's a really fun game. Best sniper game I've ever played in my life. And just the crunchy, visceral nature of it. I fucking... headshots. I love the Max Payne style of headshots, where it's like, oh, you know you got a headshot because everything's slowing down, going in the bullet time, and we got the Mortal Kombat 9 or Mortal Kombat X x-ray of fucking where the bullet enters in and where, and you can see it just flying out the back of somebody's head if it makes it all the way out there. I'm like, yes, I like. Way too violent. Incredibly violent. I'm like, man, I couldn't even imagine my brother-in-law actually liking this. He'd be like, wow, this is way too violent. I could see my sister being fucking overly cautious because, you know, she's a mother hen now and she just doesn't want any violence to be, you know, around her children. So, really love that. Look forward to playing a lot more Sniper Elite 2. Fucking blast. And then I stumbled back upon a game that I've played 3 times. And I thought, or believed, I played to completion. Broforce. Broforce, I bought that game in early access. I played through all the levels to the end. And I'm like, yeah, that was a lot of fun. I went through all the terrorists. And I brought liberty to the world. And that was the end of it. And then they came out of early access with the full release. And I'm like, oh, fucking sweet. So I'm like, oh, shit, they added a bunch of new bros. And they added a bunch of new levels. The alien swarm. So once you defeat all the terrorists, then the aliens start showing up and infesting. Then you have to destroy all the aliens. And I did that. I defeated all the aliens and brought peace to the world again. And I'm like, oh, I'm done with it. Well, that was fun. That was pretty cool. And then, you know, just recently I was reading an update and I'm like, oh, they've added a couple more bros. So I'm like, oh, fuck, I'll wander back into Broforce and play through it again a little bit more. And I jump into it and it's like, oh, you're only 25% done. I'm like, what the fuck? And I don't know if there was some sort of weird thing with my save file, but it put me to before I defeated the aliens. So I went through, I beat all the aliens again. And then lo and behold, it's like, hey, a portal to hell has just opened up. I'm like, what the fuck is this? So I go into hell and I take on the final boss, the actual proper final boss, which is Satan, a character that you run into at the end of every level before you bring liberation to the land, raise the flag, jump on your helicopter, and watch everything explode behind you. And I'm like, oh, that makes complete sense that Satan should be the end boss. So I go, I beat Satan, and I high-five the president, and fucking... The very last section is you're standing over Satan's grave. Spoilers, if you're worried about the story of Broforce. So you're standing over Satan's grave at the very end, and it's like, hold right trigger to pay respects, and you just piss all over his grave. I'm like, yes! Like, fucking hilarious. So, yeah, I beat Broforce 3 times, but... Once. I played it up to its, well, end point every chance I got. And then, yeah, I guess they just finished the story, or they added, or I didn't do certain things last time I played it when they came out the full release. Or maybe they added in the hell levels shortly after. I'm not too sure. But either way, really, really fun-ass game. I should try playing multiplayer with that, but I've seen people try to play multiplayer, and... your bros can shoot each other. Their alts or their special abilities can hurt each other. So I think that would be just a massive fucking shit show. It's kind of like an experience I had years ago playing New Super Mario Brothers Wii with my cousin and my girlfriend at the time and a friend of ours. So the four of us playing together, you know, every time you grab a power-up, it kind of freezes the screen for a moment, or you can bounce off each other's heads, or if you go into a bubble, only your friend can pop you out of the bubble. And got to a much later level, I think World 8 we finally got to, where there's like this cloud of death gas, and we were fucking each other up so much that it's like, we can't get through this level playing with each other because we're just so disorganized. We're fucking each other over so much, it's impossible. So Derek's like, here, just let me go in by myself, and he fucking burned through it on the first try by himself because he didn't have all the obstacles, the hard mode, I suppose, of everybody else getting in his way. And yeah, that was pretty much the end of it there, because it's like, well, we can't do any more levels together, as far as we could tell, because we were just fucking each other up so bad. So yeah, I don't think we ever played that ever again after, which sucks, because that was a ton of fun, that game. Jesus. Let's see. Oh, yes. The BioShock Remastered Editions came out yesterday. Took fucking long enough, too. I thought that they'd release around noon. Didn't come out till like 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. But I fired up BioShock, my third platform playing it. Played it for a couple of minutes just to see how it looked. And fucking, I'm going to be playing BioShock again all the way through. That'll be the third fucking time. First time was on the Xbox 360 years and years and years ago. Jesus, I think I was on my like old launch unit, the one that would freeze up every hour or so, depending on the game. I tried playing Crackdown on that. And, oh yeah, it did freeze up every half hour or so because I had to fucking save every 15 minutes in BioShock. I remember that. That was an added level of fucking terror and tension where you're playing the game and you're like, okay, I've beat this big daddy, and you just save as quickly as you can before the fucking Xbox freezes and you lose all your progress and you have to fucking fight him again. I'm like, God damn it. God damn you, big daddy. Why are you so tough? Yeah, fuck, I completely forgot. Oh, man. And I remember I was still dating Bobby at the time, and her mother had gotten sick and she was in the hospital. I remember her auntie and two aunts were staying over here, and I had gotten to a part where you beat Andrew Ryan to death with a golf club. And I remember playing that on my TV with the speakers loud, fucking right there, and they're sitting here in the kitchen just talking about, you know, worried about Bobby's mom. And man, I was an ignorant piece of shit back then. Only 10 short years ago, I was a sack of shit that was so, had my head so far up my ass, it's amazing I ever found daylight again. God damn. And then when they released it on the PlayStation 3, I picked up and played it on there, and it was a lot harder. I don't know why. I think the reticle was a lot smaller. It seemed like it was. It seemed like it was a fuck of a lot harder to hit things with the reticle on the PlayStation 3 version, and played through all that again, and god damn, that was fun. Did a bit better, but took me a little bit of time to get used to the reticle being a bit of a bastard. But and now, the PC version, but I'll be playing that with my Xbox One controller, so it's, well, mind you, that'd probably be even easier with mouse and keyboard, but nah, I don't feel like it with mouse and keyboard. It'd be too difficult to organize the plasmids and all that shit with my fingers. Ran into that problem today. I started playing a game and I'm like, it's like, hit the F key to turn on your flashlight. I'm like, where the hell's the F key? Where, fuck, should be that little dimple on it. I can't, god damn it, I had to look. I'm like, fuck. This makes for good content where it's like, I can't find the key I need to hit to continue shit. Yeah. In the remastered version, it's kind of interesting that, you know, they added a couple of things. You can see the bit more, not foliage because you're underwater, seaweed and such. And I think they've up-resed a lot of the signage and the graphics and, well, the resolution of such things. And I hope that they changed some character models, because I remember it wasn't Fontaine, because I believe that, no, Fontaine does exist in the first one. That's not the second one. God damn. I look forward to BioShock 2 looking a hell of a lot better, too. I'll be playing that as well. But I have to start, you know, first things first. And I hope that, who the hell is it? It's the lady doctor that is gathering all the, or trying to save the little sisters. She was just a reskin of one of the splicers, just without the bandages on her face. I hope that they kind of put in some extra work and trying to give her a completely new and well-rounded or more rendered character model. That would be great. I would really appreciate that, because I was, even at the time of playing BioShock, I'm like, oh man, this is great. But even then, I kind of recognized, like, they cheaped out in a couple of places. Something that I really noticed in BioShock 2. I think that's when it really stuck out in my head, was that BioShock 2, any character that, you know, was unique, actually had his own character model, was specifically made for that. Maybe bits and parts of him were reused on splicers, or they're covered up in a very unique way that you couldn't tell the difference. But yeah, they seem like they all stood out individually, which was great. Where there wasn't really a lot of individual characters that you ran into in BioShock 2, but there was enough that you looked back at BioShock and you're like, you guys kind of rushed that, or you didn't have time to build a completely separate person just for this, you know, specific instance. And then going into Infinite, well, they fucking spared no expense, or at least it appeared they didn't until, you know, that ghost fight near the end. That was a little, okay. But yes, very excited, looking forward to playing BioShock, and you might see that. Might see that somewhere, who knows. So I've had a really fucked up sleeping schedule for the past, well, 2 weeks I've been unemployed. I go to bed late, and I wake up late, and then I just stopped going to bed late and started going to bed in the middle of the day. I would, you know, stay up until like 6 a.m. and then sleep until 1 in the afternoon. And I'm like, fuck, I can't keep doing this. Jesus. Seems like the days are just fucking disappearing. But then again, I'm spending all night playing video games. So I can't complain. And I remember something that my mama said to me when I, you know, first lost my job. She's like, don't spend all your time playing video games. Well, shit. Sorry, mama. You knew that was coming. You knew how much I loved them. So yes, sleeping schedule super fucked. I tried going to bed last night at a respectable time. I woke up at 2 o'clock and I went to bed at 10 o'clock and woke up at 4 a.m. and got up and watched some Farscape and played some video games and then fell asleep again until about noon. messed up. But, you know, get it out of my system. Or at least, yeah, just enjoy myself, I guess, or do what I want while I have the time to, because when I get back into working again, then I'll have to be a normal human being, I suppose. It seems like a good idea, but who knows how that'll turn out. I finally sat down and watched The Girl Who Leapt Through Time, Mamoru Hosoda's fucking beautiful animated movie. I downloaded it years ago, like a filthy pirate, and watched and loved it. But I believe I only watched like the 720p version. Maybe it was even standard definition. I'm not even too clear on what that was. And then finally, I'm like, fuck, I want this on Blu-ray. But the thing was that it was only, well, the North American license for it had expired, or whoever the hell had it wasn't distributing it anymore. So you can only buy the British version, or the UK PAL, yeah, sure, we'll call it that, the PAL version, or you pay $300 for the North American NTSC version. I'm like, fuck that. And then I'm like, well, it says it doesn't work, the PAL Blu-ray doesn't work on North American Blu-ray players. And I'm like, well, that's bullshit, because there should be only region A and region B, and as far as I know, there's no region locking for Blu-rays. I guess at some point they instigated region blocking for Blu-rays, because one night I was really drunk and I went on eBay, or I think I went on Amazon. I bought the PAL version of The Girl Who Leapt Through Time for like $13. And I'm like, fucking A. So it finally shows up one day. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, oh yeah, I guess I bought this when I was drunk. Another pleasant drunken surprise. And I popped into my Blu-ray player and it's like, nah, it doesn't work. I'm like, the fuck are you talking about doesn't work? When did region locking become a thing? I thought that was like a thing of the past, or with the old DVD days. I think there was like 5 regions. Those are like regions 1 through 5. Literally. I think it was numbered like that. And then on the Blu-rays, they only had regions A and B, to my knowledge. And like, yeah, with that, I think the thing that I mistaken was that region A is Japan and North America. And that's why I'm like, oh, there's no such thing as region locking anymore, because I can get all my Japanese Blu-rays, which have the subtitles, which I'm perfectly fine with, and watch my animus that way. But I guess region B is literally still locked. And yeah, they, except I bought a Blu-ray. It was, what the hell was it? It was the Top Gear Arctic, when they went to the Arctic Circle. I was very disappointed in that Blu-ray because they didn't manage to maintain the music license rights that they had on the original broadcast version, which had, you know, Beach Boys and music from the John Carpenter's 1989 Thing, which I really enjoyed. And then I got the Blu-ray version, and they didn't have that, well, that licensed music. They had different licensed music, and it just isn't as good. Maybe there's been so much time. I have to rewatch that. It's been, I think, over 5 years that I don't remember how awesome that music fit in. That to rewatch their Polar Special, I believe that's what it's called. Again, now I won't be so disappointed, being like, "Oh man, this was so much better when they had the Beach Boys." That, or I still have it downloaded. I'll just rewatch that, like a filthy pirate. Goddamn! Everything else I've been fucking clearing out. Oh God, it's just been a fire sale on data. God, I finally deleted a what the hell was it? I think it was 120 gigabyte. Let's Play series, but it wasn't a Let's Play series. It was Garrett Plays Batman Arkham Origins. It was my first playthrough on the PlayStation 3 version of Batman Arkham Origins, which, one, the game was fucking broken on the PlayStation 3 version, and two, the game was fucking broken. And I think they patched the shit out of it eventually and ended up not running like a bag of shit and having a ton of technical issues and bugs and problems. Good job, Warner Brothers Montreal, for shitting the bed on that one. I don't think they're ever given a fucking project again after that. I may be completely mistaken and wrong. Actually, you know what? I'm going to check. Because I kind of hope that Warner Brothers Montreal was never given a project after Arkham Origins. They were supposed to do, I think, a Suicide Squad video game a few years after they were building up to it with the same engine. But I think they, after the reception of Arkham Origins just being shit, like technically shit, the game I thought was, I love the story, fantastic, amazing story, but whoa. WB Montreal, let's see, subsidiary, Interactive Entertainment, products, Batman Arkham Origins. Oh, here we go. They did the Batman Arkham City Armored Edition for the Wii U, and then with that, they were given the, Cartoon Universe. What the fuck is this? Warner Brothers Entertainment, Cartoon Universe. See a lot of shit in here, but did they touch anything out of, like, I'm looking at, Game Parties, Lego Batman... That doesn't tell me anything, really. Oh, for the web. What the fuck? Then they were given Batman Arkham Origins. And that, yeah, everyone knows how much that worked out. And then Lego Legends of Chima Online. What? So they got a Wii U port of an old game that nobody played because everyone played Arkham City years ago on all the good consoles. And then it came on the Wii U and they're like, yeah, whatever. Then they had a online distribution web thing for a bunch of cartoon games. And then there's this Lego game that came out on Windows and iOS, so mobile and PC. And it's like some sort of online Lego game that I've never heard of. And that was back in 2014. So, wow, Batman Arkham Origins came out in 2013? That was only 3 years ago? I thought that fucking Arkham Knight came out, like, I guess that was only last year, wasn't it? It was just all the bullshit and kerfuffle. It seemed so much longer ago. Ha! Yeah, so they were given all those projects, and maybe they're still working on a Suicide Squad game. It doesn't say whether or not they are working on anything else, or if they were just shuttered after because fucking they never really did anything good. Sorry. You know, Warner Brothers Montreal, Canadian-based development company. Imagine you guys, fucking pretty solid guys, but, oh, you needed some bug testing on that game. You needed to give QA. What is with, I can't really give shit to Eidos Montreal, because the super best friends, the guys I listen to and watch on YouTube, are, the majority of them are from the Eidos Montreal Q&A team, and that's, I guess, how they got into playing video games on YouTube, or where their interest for that is just a passion. But, yeah. Warner Brothers Montreal. You need a better QA team. Fuck. I have been doing a little bit of baking. Now, years ago, when Bobby still lived with me, I used to make Rice Krispie squares and cookies and fudge brownies and all kinds. I used to bake a lot because I really enjoy baking, making delicious food, or making food that is compelling and good to me. Hell, Ryan always loved my Rice Krispie squares because I put in about 3.5 times more marshmallows than it recommends. I remember my formula: 8 full-size marshmallows, full-size marshmallows, to every cup of Rice Krispies, and then, you know, a little bit of vanilla extract and some margarine, although it calls for butter. Maybe I should cut down that margarine, makes them a little bit greasy. Yeah, either way. And god damn, are those good Rice Krispie squares. Fuck. I'm gonna have to make some more of those. I'm gonna have to go out and get more Rice Krispies. I bought a bunch of Rice Krispies a few years ago and just completely stopped baking for some weird reason. Maybe it was because Bobby left. I just didn't feel like baking a bunch of goodies and treats for myself. And I imagine that they've gone stale and bad. I mean, I have to pop open that bag and try them because I did have one bag that was opened and was like half. And I'm like, yeah, try these. I'm like, oh, those are stale. Those are like 3 years stale. Holy fuck. So I have to try those out, and then I'll probably be going out and buying a shitload of Rice Krispies. And making some cookies. Fuck, it's been a long time since I've had my chocolate chip cookies. Thing I like about those? Double the amount of chocolate chips they ask for. Always put in a lot more of the thing I want more of. This is, good shit. Did a little bit of cleaning up. Cleaned up my spare room a tiny bit. Finally put together the toilet cabinet that I bought, last year sometime. And it's been sitting in the box in the spare room, just kind of forgotten and neglected. Finally got around to putting that together. Just need to finish painting my bathroom. And then I can put that toilet cabinet over top there. So I have more storage for, don't really have much to put in my bathroom. But still, it's good to have more storage. I can put the soap rack back in the tub. That would be fantastic. And I don't know, I'm kind of on a half and half decision of whether I'm going to put the shelf under the cabinet of my vanity or just leave it out. Because putting the shelf in there, all I can really do is, I suppose, put like towels or whatever underneath. But I keep my towels in the linen closet. I don't really have too many of them. And so, it kind of seems like a bit of a, obstruction. It seems like where you'll put things and then you'll just never see them anymore is underneath the shelf that's not really needed. So, still thinking, deciding about that. Maybe I really should, because it's not that big of a deal. I just have to cut out a hole in it where the plumbing stack is and then cut a little bit of a keyhole, I suppose, to slide that in and slide that around. But have to measure and figure that out, and I'm gonna have to make a big fucking mess on that because I have to angle it and to get it around the pipe. It's gonna be weird. I'll figure it out. I'll look into it and see how that's gonna be. If it's gonna be too much effort, then fuck it. It's not worth it. That's how I do things. If it looks like it's gonna be hard, I give up immediately. Yes, fuck giving, putting effort towards shit. I also played, It Came from Outer Space and Ate Our Brains, which is another wave-based, kind of blocky Minecraft isometric top-down shooter. Not quite like that Alien Swarm, where Alien Swarm was actually looked really good. This one's really, really basic, but, it's kind of mid-wave, upgrade your weapons kind of shooter. It somewhat reminds me of, not Rezogun, because Rezogun had that really cool aesthetic to it, but Dead Nation. Pretty much identical Dead Nation. It just looks like Minecraft with a gun Dead Nation, and you're shooting aliens instead of hordes of zombies. And, it's a hell of a lot easier. It Came from Outer Space and Ate Our Brains. It was a recommendation by a former coworker of mine, Carl. He's like, hey, this looks like a lot of fun, and looked like it'd be a lot of fun to play with other people. I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll pick that up. So I picked up when it was on sale, and never played with him yet. Still haven't played with him. That guy's been playing a lot of Borderlands 2, and, I'd like to play with him, but I don't know. He got up to level 25, and I don't want to jump into his game while I'm level 1 again and have to kind of slide through. And that I've never really, I played a little bit of Borderlands 2 with Ryan a few years ago, and then it got so infrequent that he started playing without me. I'm like, what the fuck, dude? He's like, hey man, you're not around to play. I'm like, I work, I have a job, you know, maybe ask me. Didn't even ask me. He's just like, oh, Garrett's not around, so I'll just play by myself. Now, hey man, you want to play? Never. Fucking never. Just went to himself. I'm like, well, fine. Fuck you. I guess we'll never play that again. Jesus. Going off on your own. Bastard. But, you know, Carl never had really that gentleman's agreement to it. It was just, hey man, you got Borderlands 2? We should play that. But actually, I'm like, hey man, we should play Borderlands. And then he started playing that. I'm like, okay, cool. Thanks for not ever mentioning it to me. You just play it whenever you want. Sure. whatever. And I finally filed for EI, Employment Insurance. I am finally on the pokey boy. Oh yeah, no more sitting around and wondering, money's gonna run out sometime soon. What am I gonna do? I guess I'm fucked. No, now I'm gonna be government funded for a little bit. Ride that out for, maybe a month. Yeah. Maybe get a check or two and then be like, yeah, no, I don't think I'll be able to survive off this. And then go out and get a real job. And, you know, stick around, stock up on some content and entertain the masses while I have the time. If I have the time. So, yes, that has been it. I don't know if chat broke or whatever, but either way. Well, thank you very much for watching another Lefebvre's Friday for September 16th, 2016. And as always, take her easy.